Hello, hello, hello. I just want to remind you that we have Caramu each and every Friday night right here in Montgomery, Alabama. If you want to find out where, if you want to find out what time, all you need to do is call this number, and that is 334-399-7737. That's 334-399-77. John Henry Drums, home of the Majestic Mind Matters University.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. Welcome to CMOTAP, the Committee to Eliminate Media Offensive to African People. How many people are here for their first time? Could I see by a raise of hands? Let's give them a round of applause and thank them for joining us today. We are blessed today to have one of the foremost scholars of our history, one of the foremost authors, educators, and warriors for our people. And he is joining the ranks of many, many other great ones that have been here. And we know the quality of his work, and we know that the fact that so many new people came, that you're aware of his work also. If you look around you, I hope that you feel yourself. These paintings you see over here in the middle, the abstracts, they're from a brother, William Osiris Caldwell, who willed them to us when he died. There are other pictures and paintings that have been donated from various sources. In the back, you'll see two large depictions of Pharaoh and the Pharaoh's wife in the back on that side of the wall in green. And if you look in the front, if the screen wasn't here, you'll see a sphinx with a picture of Dr. Yosef Ben-Yakinen on one side and a picture of Dr. Clark on the other. And you'll notice that that door in the back is painted a particular way. The cover on the radiator is painted in African motifs. The artist who did that is here today with us. I'd like to acknowledge him. Brother Lucian, would you please stand up? It's like a dream. Brother Lucian just came, and in fact, we had many of these paintings. There's a whole wall of pictures of our African musicians that hasn't been put back up yet. But these things were all lined up by Lucian with using the, a level and all kinds of things. They've gotten a little out of shape right now, but the design of the whole overall arrangement of our pictures and stuff was done by Brother Lucian. But I'm afraid that one day Brother Lucian is going to wake up and say, wait a minute, I gave this to these people for free? You know? Thank you, brother. No problem. Thank you. That's Sister Yvonne, one of the original members of CMOTAP. Give her a round of applause. There are always people working behind the scenes when you go somewhere. Has anybody been to the restroom yet? You'll find nice, clean restrooms, right? Somebody clean that, right? They're not standing up here at the mic. Let's give them a round of applause. The floor was scraped and redone. Somebody did that. He's not standing in front of the mic, right? So we give him a round of applause. And all of you found out about this somewhere, and we also, we just want to acknowledge all of those people who have made today's program come about. So I was telling you about Brother Lucian. Brother Lucian came and he's donated these things to Semhotep for free. And this was his, this Sphinx is really unbelievable. I asked you to come up and take a look at it before you leave so you can just basically see the love that is being shared with you coming from our ancestors. So I'm going to get out of the way through Lucian, of course. I'm going to get out of the way. I think that you came here to see Brother Tony Browder. I'll let you know that you can see him today. You can see him again tomorrow at the Board for the Education for People of African Ancestry in Harlem at 286 Convent Avenue, and that'll be at 3 p.m. That's the John Henry Clark House, 286 Convent Avenue between 141st and 142nd at 3 p.m. tomorrow. And I think all of you are familiar with Brother Browder. If not, I see he has some of his works out here laid out for you. Nile Valley Civilization, Survival Strategies from the Browder File, and a bunch of tapes. I ask you to please make sure that you support him by purchasing those things. Also support our brother in the back, Brother Raheem. He has books. And also Brother Kamau has tapes from other Semhotep programs. When the program is finished, downstairs we have a meal. We ask you to come down and join us with that, and we can continue the conversation downstairs. So without any further delay, let me welcome to the microphone this giant, Brother Dr. Anthony Browder. Thank you.
Hotep family. It is a pleasure and an honor to be here and to be in the city that Dr. Ben and Dr. Clark and Dr. Jackson and so many other giants helped to put on the map and ensure that his soul remained intact. I'm sorry that I'm not going to have an opportunity to share this day with Sister Betty, who I've been in communication with over the last month to make arrangements for my visit here, but she is not able to come due to a funeral that she has to go to, but she is certainly here in spirit. And before I get started, I also want to acknowledge a sister who is no longer here, a sister who is now an ancestor, Sister Leola Maddox, who through UAM brought me to New York on the regular. And her sudden passing comes as a shock to everyone who knew her and loved her, and that we will surely miss her. And we honor and treasure all those things that she lived for, that she worked so hard for, and we have an obligation and responsibility to see to it that her work continues, or the UAM work continues in her absence. It's going to be difficult, but it's important that when critical personalities who are heads of organizations pass, that the organization itself does not pass when they leave. So we have to train our replacements in order to ensure that any endeavor that we create outlives us. That should be our job. That should be foremost among the things that we do. So again, I'm pleased to be here, pleased that you all came out to hear what I'm going to be sharing over the course of 2 days. And I was asked by a sister a little while ago if I was going to do the same presentation today that I plan to do at the Clark House tomorrow. And I told her, no, it wasn't my intention to do so. As a matter of fact, I really, since I'm among a group of people who are very sensitive as to how people of African ancestry are depicted in the media, I wanted to do a presentation that I just did last week for the first time. I wanted to share that with you all. I think it's relevant, but I wanted to survey the audience and make sure that that suggestion meets with your approval. So a show of hands, for those who would like for me to do a discussion and analysis of the film Get Out. Am I interested? Yeah? All right. Well, thank you. Well, with that, let me turn on my laptop, my PowerPoint. I already had it queued up because something just told me you all were going to say yes. So thank you for confirming that inner spirit that has always guided me and has never led me down a wrong path. So let me start up my laptop and we'll get the party started. So if you want, you can kill any of these lights to make sure that the images are good, folks can see the images. So this is just my second time doing this presentation, so excuse me if I refer to my notes. I want to make sure that I don't miss any of the information relative to this film. So for those who know me, know that I've done a series of lectures and presentations on the media. And some of the most memorable presentations that I've done have been Decoding the Secret of the Secret 11 years ago, Avatar, Precious, Django Unchained, 12 Years a Slave, The Butler, and just last year I did a presentation on Empire. So even though most people know me as a writer, as a historian, as a lecturer, with an emphasis on Nile Valley culture and civilization, my formal training, my degree, is in graphic design and advertising. Have a master's of fine arts, and I had my own graphics design studio for a number of years before I began writing and lecturing. And so one of the talents and one of the gifts that I have is that I interpret history through the eyes of an artist. I'm formally trained as an artist, and so when I see things, when I see buildings, when I see structures, when I read materials, I always see them through the eyes of an artist. I see images, I see symbols, I see things that speak to me on another level. So this is the experience that I brought to my interpretation of films. I remember Avatar. When Avatar came out a number of years ago, Avatar, I think, it was one of the greatest films ever made. On a technological level, it raised the bar. But what I found is that a number of our folk were offended by the movie in that they said it recreated a lot of the stereotypes that we see in movies. A white man goes into a community inhabited by indigenous people and he rises to the top and he saves them, blah, 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 blah. Yes, that is there, but that's not the whole movie. The movie is layered. And so what I found was that by digging deep and dealing with some of the symbolic elements within that film, it caused people to see the film through an entirely different lens. So that's one of the talents that I bring to my analysis of films that depict us, because I want us to begin to move beyond just the superficial and get to the deep substance of films that have a favorable impact on our lives. So as an artist, I really look at things from my own personal experiences, and what I know through dealing with advertising and marketing is that all media is designed to get you to do three things. One, to sit down. Sit down, to pay attention, and to spend your money. That's the whole purpose of the media. Everything is designed to separate you from your wallet. And the people who specialize in advertising and marketing study human behavior, and they know you better than you know yourselves. They know how to get inside of your head, manipulate your heart such that you feel compassion or you feel a desire for certain things. And it's that desire, that compassion, that causes you to spend money to purchase certain products. And so as an artist, as a cultural historian, my job is to educate you so that you can become an educated consumer of media content. And regarding any media, my philosophy is that the philosophy that you possess when you sit down to watch a film or to read a magazine or to listen